So the big question we are asking tonight is, rupee hits a new low. When and how will the free fall be checked? To discuss that, I'll soon be joined by Professor Arun Kumar, Professor of Economics with the JNU. I am joined by A.K. Bhattacharya, Editor with the Business Standard, S.V. Divvaakar, Global Business Advisor, Monitor and Evaluator. And I also have with me Professor Arun Kumar, Professor of Economics, JNU. He joins us from outside New Delhi. Well, I'll begin with you, Mr. Bhattacharya. In trying to control the fall of the rupee, are the government and the RBI attacking the root of the problem? What exactly is the root of the problem? Is it fundamentals of the economy?
Well, as you rightly said, the government and the RBI perhaps are ignoring the structural problems that have arisen over the last couple of years, which is mainly current account deficit. So the widening of the current account deficit for two consecutive years to over 4% of GDP have caused this problem, where the markets have got wind of the government's inability to tackle those structural problems with policy measures. Now, when you do see that, the rupee, now we have a floating rate of exchange management, you do see these weakening of the Indian rupee. So I see the rupee as a symptom of the structural weaknesses in the economy and the government's failure to tackle those problems. And unless and until those problems are tackled or enough indication is given that the government and the RBI are keen and determined to tackle those problems, I think the market will behave in this manner. And because it is not like 1991, where we are by and large a closed economy, today you have we are an open economy. We are exposed to global forces, and foreign capital does play an important role in the Indian economy today. So therefore, you are seeing this choppiness, and until the government and the RBI actually can instill that sense of confidence in the market, that the government is determined and capable to take those effective measures to control India's current account deficit and bring it down.
A number of announcements were made insofar as hiking FDI limits in various sectors are concerned, but none of that seems to have boosted the confidence of investors, be it for institutional investors or domestic investors. I'll ask you the same question. Are the symptoms being addressed, or is the root cause of the problem being addressed?
Sure. I think what we are seeing here is a symptom of manifestations which have happened over the last few years. And my feeling is that the larger underlying problem is that there has been a steady and progressive deterioration in the quality of capital in the economy. We have historically been able to manage current account deficits because of a healthy inflow of foreign direct investment in the past. So if you look at the last 3 year trends, FDI used to be averaging about $5.7 billion a month in, let's say, 2008-2009, which is one of our best economic growth years. And you compare that with what's happening today, it's about $1.9 billion a month. Even the remittance flows, which are largely migrant remittances from Asian countries, that has dipped by about 20-25% because of the weak economic conditions. So these two high quality, durable forms of capital, which have been the bastions of the so-called Indian economy's resilience in terms of maintaining its economic its exchange rate, have definitely been progressively declining in the last few years, and that has been replaced by shorter term capital and volatile capital to an extent. This 30% of debt being external currency borrowings, which is all in the private sector now. Mm-hmm. and about $170 billion of redemptions coming up in the next 1 year. All these together, if one looks at it from a future perspective of the next 6 months, whether India is a market where you would invest or not, taking the sum totality of these conditions, I think the decisions tend to be very conservative in the international capital market, especially for long-term investors who are interested in capital investment. Mm-hmm. So I think the underlying cause is much more than the symptom that we see. What has happened in the last week with the information of the Fed withdrawing the monetary stimulus is just a knee-jerk issue, and I'm sure, like the minister said, this would undergo a short-term correction. Mm-hmm. But the longer-term answer to all of this lies in sending out a very strong signal that there is stability in terms of the liberalization, there is a market increase in the facilitation of investment capital, and these are the kind of issues that we need to fix.
Right. Professor Kumar, I'll come to you now. The chief economist with the World Bank and ex-chief economic advisor to the finance ministry, Mr. Kaushik Basu, has said that the capital control measures that have been taken recently by the RBI were unwarranted. There are some experts who say that perhaps there is a need for a paradigm shift in the way the RBI is working upon the monetary policy. It is not just important for the RBI to concentrate on growth, but also on the sources and structures of growth. Would you agree that a shift, paradigm shift, so to say, is required in the way the RBI is dealing with its monetary policy?
Well, we have to understand why the problem has arisen. And the first thing I'd like to point out is that these are short-term fluctuations, which are based on changes in expectations of the various entities which are investing in India or dealing with India. Now, in this change of expectations, two things are important. One is what has happened with the quantitative easing or the expectations about quantitative easing and the better performance of the US economy. And the second is that the Indian economy seems to be going downhill with the rate of growth coming down, the industrial rate of growth coming down, the agricultural rate of growth may go up a little bit this year, but it won't compensate for the decline in the services growth and the industrial growth. On the other hand, also inflation is high, the fiscal deficit is tending to be high, and as has been pointed out, the current account deficit is fairly high. So there are internal weaknesses in contrast to the growing external strength of the US economy, and this is the contrast within which the Indian economy is not looking very good and people have lost confidence in the Indian economy, and that's why the FIIs have been pulling out money from the Indian economy. Now, in this kind of a situation, the question is how do you change the expectations? And I think that's what Professor Kaushik Basu is trying to refer to when he says that whether capital controls of the kind that were brought in last week, whether they should have been brought in, what are they doing to expectations? Similarly, for instance, when you impose a duty on gold and the gold prices tend to go up because there is devaluation of the currency as well as because there is a duty on gold, so people may begin to buy more gold and more smuggling may begin to take place. So question is how to change these expectations about the economy. And I think that's where the government has a large role to play. The government is trying to curb the current account deficit by placing controls and raising the exports, the import duties on various items. And on the other hand, it is trying to boost the Indian economy by trying to invest more. And I think these kind of steps, if they are taken in a very consistent manner, rather than in an ad hoc manner and only in a limited fashion, then there is a problem. Finally, the problem that's coming up before the Indian economy is the elections that are coming in the next 9 to 10 months. And there's a lot of uncertainty about what will happen, whether the elections will be earlier or whether the elections will be later, and what will happen in the elections, who will be the new government, and whether the new government will be a coalition, and therefore whether it will be able to carry forward the program that this government puts forward. So in other words, there's a large uncertainty about the Indian economy, whereas the US economy is doing much better, and therefore all this is putting pressure on the Indian economy and therefore putting pressure on the rupee dollar parity.
All right, so you've raised some very interesting aspects, Professor Kumar. You've said that are the steps which the government and the RBI are taking reactionary in nature? Are investors really waiting for elections to take place so that there is certainty in policy? Are they waiting for this present economic crisis to go away? Are they sitting out the present economic crisis? Those are some interesting aspects that you've brought up, which we will be discussing after a short break. Please don't go anywhere. We'll be asking after the break as to why have the recent measures, and we'll be talking specifically about the recent measures which the RBI and the government have unveiled in order to control the rupee. We'll be asking why are they not working. So we are asking tonight as to why have the measures which the government and the RBI have taken recently to control the free fall of the rupee not borne fruit. I'll come to you, Mr. Bhattacharya.
Yes.
An interesting aspect which Professor Kumar raised before the break was that elections are one of the very important imponderables. Perhaps investors are trying to sit out this crisis, waiting for the next government and then thinking about making investments.
Well, yes, elections are a factor, but they're not the only factor. Yes, investors are worried about a long winter ahead, where political uncertainty might rob the government of its ability to take decisive action and push the reform agenda ahead. So, to that extent, the elections ahead are a factor. But let me say that the government has also been has not been vigilant enough to focus on the basic problems in the economy and not allowing the rupee to find its level as the market determines, because if the instead of trying to stop the rupee and trying to provide a kind of a float to the rupee by using measures that actually are sending out contrary signals, has done more damage than the growth story and to a sustained credibility of the government's measures. Now, what has happened now is that you have seen the last at least 4 weeks, all the measures the government has taken, the market has disbelieved them. And actually, the rupee has fallen from one level to the other. So today, you have crossed 63. Now, the market, I think, understands this nervousness on the part of the government. And therefore, the government must come to terms with the fact that the rupee will depreciate. And therefore, and as long as the current account deficit is that wide, the rupee will depreciate. And if it reaches a level where 63 or 64 or 65, whatever the level may be, you will find foreign flows should come back. Mm-hmm. At that point, maybe investing back into the country in this economy will become remunerative. So I think it is, you know, instead of fighting the market, the government should allow the market to have its play and at the same time take necessary steps by which.
But many people ask whether this is really a practical solution, what you are suggesting, that allow the rupee to find its own level. Mr. Divvaakar, one question that comes to mind is, and you in a way obliquely referred to it, that whether the impact of the rollback of the quantitative easing of by the Fed Reserve, is that really overrated? Because the data I have says that over the last decade, when the global economy was doing well between 2002 and 2008, the rupee was stable at about rupees 45 to a dollar. When the global crisis erupted in 2008 and continued under 2012, the rupee still was stable at rupees 45. It started to decline only in 2012, just as the global economy was beginning to look up. So when the global economy was doing well, the rupee was doing good. When it was not doing so well, again the rupee was doing good. Now when it's picking up, you can't blame the upswing in the global economy for the fall of the rupee.
Precisely my point. And therefore I said that this is a symptomatic of a larger underlying problem. But I think coming back to the core argument, I think we have to recognize that the foreign investment attractiveness of India has traditionally been in the form of a market opening to investors, as well as a lower cost and a competitive manufacturing base. Now, that competitiveness in manufacturing clearly has eroded over the last few years, and it is not something which it's in the hands of the RBI or in a certain specific policy, but it is a series of things.
It's a combination of fiscal measures as well as monetary measures. Yes. Overall economic policy measures.
Absolutely.
Okay. So. Since I have very limited time, I'm almost out of time. Professor Kumar, I'll give you the last word. An interesting aside today was a meeting which the finance minister had called with secretaries of four different departments within the ministry, asking them for a 10-point action plan on how to revive the sentiment in the economy, to revive the economy as a whole. Do you think now perhaps the government is wanting and trying to think long-term and move beyond any sort of short-term measures to control the fall of the rupee? And is that a good sign if indeed that is the case?
You know, markets are not self-correcting. This is something that Alan Greenspan pointed out in the Senate hearings in 2008. And it does require a certain degree of regulation by the government to actually see that the rupee does not fall. Because in economics, there are something called self-fulfilling expectations. When the rupee begins to fall, then a panic can take place in which exporters and importers behave in a contrary manner, and therefore the rupee can continue to begin to fall. Those who are moving capital, they can also behave in a contrary manner, and thereby aggravate the situation. So in other words, the government does play a role, and always foreign exchange rates are managed. Even when there's a float, the foreign exchange rates are not quite left free to the market. There is certain guidance that is given. So that's very important. But I'd like to point to one other very structural problem. In 2007-8, the Indian economy's investment savings rate had peaked at about 38%. And since then, it has fallen to 30%. And that is one of the causes for why there has been a fall in the rate of growth of the Indian economy and why it has impacted the manufacturing sector and so on. And this is a measure that the government can take, is to build infrastructure in the Indian economy, begin to invest more, and that will then bring in more investment from outside as well. And perhaps if the rate of growth goes up, then this confidence in the Indian economy would revive. So in other words, government can play a very proactive role even in the current situation.
All right, on that note, thank you, Professor Arun Kumar, A.K. Bhattacharya, and S.V. Divvaakar for joining us on News 9. So the consensus on the panel is that think long term, think about manufacturing, think about boosting exports, take a relook at the fiscal policy as well as the monetary policy and make them in tandem with the present times in order to alleviate the present economic crisis.